today we're going to talk about otitis. Quick overview of the lecture. We're going to start out with some anatomy and physiology because I know that's all of our favorite parts of school that we don't remember anymore. And then we're going to focus the meat of the presentation on otitis externa. So what are the causes of it? What factors play into perpetuating it? What diagnostics do we need to be doing? Cytology is obviously something I'm going to harp on a lot, but there's other stuff that can be done. And then I try to make the meat of the presentation about treatments because that is certainly the thing that I get the most questions about. So I'll try to focus on those things. I'm glad that our sponsor was not somebody who makes these products because I'm trying not to be biased with them, but we do have some opinions, and I will tell them to you. And then we'll talk very briefly about otitis media and some of the diagnostics and clinical signs for that disease, but mostly it's going to be otitis externa because that's our common disease. And this is a disclaimer coming from my boss lady, but everyone treats otitis externa differently, particularly in the derm world. So there's not a certain way you have to do it. There's just a few things that will help you along the way that should be pretty consistent, we think. So I like this diagram of the ear. It's definitely not to scale because this middle ear is about the size of a dog's brain. So it's not that big typically, but I like the color coding to tell us where we are. And then I especially like this. So we have our pinna, our vertical canal, our horizontal canal, and then the junction between the vertical and horizontal canal is going to be an important thing to talk about for our otic exam because it's this protuberance here that when you're going in with your otoscope cone and you hit it, that's when the dog jumps. So that's just something to remember when you're doing your otic exams. I also like this X here because it shows you how far you need to be going into the canal to see what you need to see. And it's really not that far into the vertical canal to be able to see everything. It's just going to depend on your manipulation of the ear. And we'll get into more detail about that later. So we have the middle ear with the tympanic membrane at the junction of our external canal, and we have our ossicles here, and then the inner ear, which we're not going to talk very much about because that's neuro world. And here's just a picture of the outside cartilage of the dog, and it's not super important for you to know any of these structures except this intertragic incisure, which is where you're going to be putting your cone in. So if this is the right ear of the dog, that's where the otoscope cone is going to go. And I try to rest it against that area, and that's how I enter the canal, and that's they don't jump as much if you do that, if you can get some good grip on it. And then here's the tympanic membrane. This part up here is the pars flaccida, the part with all the vessels. And I just bring that up. None of our otoscope cones, the handheld ones, are going to give you that good of a view of the tympanic membrane. But a lot of folks will see that area and think that it's a mass at the level of the TM. So just to let you know, it can be a normal structure. And the kicker is anesthetized patients will often have a bulging pars flaccida of the tympanic membrane. So you've got a patient under anesthesia, you see this area, you think it's a mass. It's not. It's normal. And then there's the pars tensa. That's where we're going to perform our meningotomies. We'll come back to this picture a little bit later, but here's one of the ossicles. This one, it's the manubrium of the malleus, and it points rostrally, so you know that this is a right ear as well. So ears are essentially extensions of the skin with, you know, a few different factors. That's why they put it into our specialty, I suppose. There's a thin epidermis and dermis in the ears, but there's a ton of adnexal units. So there's going to be hair follicles. And if you think back to this picture here, it's not great, but usually the hair follicles are right at this area. So that gives you a good landmark to know that you're close to the TM. So if there's a ton of goo back there and you're not feeling good about what you're seeing, you can see that hair sometimes and think, hey, okay, I'm at the right level. There are sebaceous glands. These increase in density along the canal going towards the penna, whereas the cerumen glands, which are modified apocrine glands, are going to increase in density towards the tympanic membrane, so when you're getting closer to that horizontal canal. Cerumen is actually composed of desquamated keratinocytes, as well as some of their intercellular debris and glandular secretions from the canal. So those cerumen glands and those sebaceous glands are going to kind of make up that ball of earwax that we see all the time. The function of earwax, theoretically, is to protect the canal. So it's supposed to trap foreign material. It's supposed to be antimicrobial, and so they've done all kinds of studies and identified antibodies in the cerumen, but they don't do a great job of getting rid of ear infections, or I wouldn't have a job. So I wouldn't trust their antimicrobial abilities. And so the ears have this really cool thing that's called epithelial migration, and it's basically a way for the ear canals to clean themselves. And so the skin cells will migrate from the TM towards the vertical canal, and that's how the wax eventually gets out. It's supposed to clean, as I said, get rid of that debris, and it's going to prevent the conductive hearing loss that would normally occur if you had a ton of wax at the level of the tympanic membrane. It's also going to repair your TM if there's a rupture, and it's pretty miraculous how quickly they do repair themselves. And it's also going to keep that tympanic membrane really thin so that we can still hear through it. In that same picture, this is from our Derm Bible, but it just shows that radial migration of those keratinocytes of the TM moving outwards. So as the colors get darker, that's where these black dots moved along in the migration. So it's pretty cool. And the TM is actually an extension of the epithelium of the horizontal canal. So it just moves straight off of the TM with the epithelial migration into the canal. Humidity, 88.5. As you can imagine, this is pretty conducive to growing some organisms at times. The pH is theoretically 6.2. There's a bunch of studies. There's a bunch of different numbers. There's even a study that tells how ears are supposed to lower their mean pH when an infection's starting, because it's thought to be antimicrobial, but once again, it doesn't typically work. And there is normally microflora in the ear, so you're going to have low levels of yeast and low levels of bacteria normally, and this is why it's going to be really important to evaluate the clinical status of the pet. So if you have a Cocker Spaniel and you do an ear cytology on it, and you see 5 yeast, is the animal shaking its head? Is it itchy? It might not be something that you need to treat. It could be normal for that animal. Okay, so here's to the good stuff. Otitis externa. There's primary causes and secondary causes. The primary causes are going to be sort of a primary disease process, whereas the secondary are going to be infectious things, typically things that are taking advantage of a diseased ear that's already pathologic. And we have some perpetuating factors that are going to make ear infections, more frequent and chronic in nature, and then some predisposing factors. So before they even happen, this is going to set them up for ear infections in the future. Primary causes, immune-mediated, we have allergy in that category. So certainly atopy is going to be a big factor in ear disease for a lot of animals. Food allergy can also be a factor for a primary cause for otitis externa. And that's in dogs that I'm focusing on mostly. Cats, as I was discussing with one of you guys earlier, they don't read the book. So flea allergy, for example, I would still not rule out as a cause for otitis externa in kitties. Maybe not the most typical presentation, but I would not rule it out because they just make their own reaction patterns. But in dogs, I would say flea allergy is not going to cause otitis typically. Endocrinopathies, so things like Cushing's disease and hypothyroidism. I've seen both of these diseases where the only clinical sign was otitis externa. And it might be really early in the disease process, but it's something that maybe you would think about as a primary cause. Foreign bodies, so when you think about grass-ons, particularly in the West, but hunting dogs, things like that, I would just be aware that that's a possibility. The kicker is they're just really hard to see. Once there's an infection set up particularly, and I've also actually had some cases that were transferred to me via emergency for a grass-on in the ear, and it did have a horrible yeast otitis, but they just saw that ear at the level of the tympanic, or the hair at the level of the TM that they thought was a grass-on. So just something to think about. They're not very common, and for them to sit perfectly against the TM like that would be kind of strange too. I forgot to mention autoimmune diseases. So this is a patient of mine that I saw recently that has juvenile cellulitis, and he had a really terrible otitis externa as a result of his primary disease process. There's infectious causes that can be primary as well. So fungal disease, aspergillus, parasites, of course, you guys probably see a lot more frequently than we do because animals are on flea control, so unless you're doing a shelter situation or a new pet, we usually don't see them in our practice. And then viral, for example, distemper virus could theoretically cause otitis externa. We don't see those terribly often either. And then our secondary causes, and I think this is probably more what you guys think of as causing ear infections. Bacteria, certainly cocci and rods are the two big differentiating things we want to look for under the microscope. And if you can do a grand stain, great. We'll talk about culture a little later. And then Malassezia is probably the one we see the most frequently. Other fungi can be a factor as well. And then contact reaction, which is something I think people forget to think about. So most of the time, you're not gonna see a pet with fresh ears that has ear problems. They're gonna have a bag. They bring in the Ziploc bag or the Walmart bag and they dump it onto the table. And you know, I used this one yesterday and I used this one for a little while. And so your job gets to be to sort through that. And we'll talk about what ingredients to look for, but it's important to know what other products they've been on, particularly if they had a yeast otitis. They come into you, they've been on meds, and it's way worse, and the ear canals are ulcerated, for example. So that doesn't really make sense for a yeast otitis after 5 days of what you would think would be good treatment. But we can talk about it a little bit later. And then overcleaning the ears as well. So if you use a flush that's too aggressive or you're doing it too frequently, it's actually going to macerate that ear canal and cause it to be a little bit more friable. And I'll say this probably 80 times, but typically we'll do twice a week flushing for our ceruminolytic flushes. Any more than that can be a little too aggressive, or after bathing and swimming. And then our perpetuating factors. So I talked about that cool epithelial migration. Well, it's broken in these dogs. And so maybe it was working at first, but after their first ear infection, their second, this process starts to break down and they don't have that cleaning mechanism anymore. And that's going to make chronic ear infections more likely. And then, of course, everybody's probably seen an ear canal that looks similar to this in a Westie or a Cocker Spaniel. So we have these horrible proliferative changes in the epidermis and dermis of these ears, and the ear canals become super stenotic. Not always irreversible. Some of this inflammation can be reversed, but it's certainly going to set them up for infections chronically. And then a ruptured tympanum, otitis media, those are things that are potentially going to be nidus's for infection. So if you're not getting the response that you want out of your treatment, that's something to think about, that they might have middle ear disease as well. And then calcification of the ear canals. Another poster child breed would be the Cocker Spaniel that comes in and they just have two cylindrical rocks on the sides of their heads, super calcified canals. And those guys, unfortunately, we're probably not going to be able to fix with medical management. So they might be good surgical candidates. And then lastly, our predisposing factors. So confirmation, so breed predisposition, essentially. So if anyone's ever tried to look in a Shar Pei ear, it's just like this blind-ending tube. You can't even get your otoscope cone in there. So of course, that's going to make their ear infections a little bit more difficult to deal with. Excessive moisture, bathing, swimming. That's why it's important to have a flush as a maintenance, but also after they're in the water is never a bad idea. And then obstructive lesions, so things like neoplasia are something that can be a predisposing factor. There's actually not a whole lot of masses that are growing in ear canals that won't get secondary infection. So, you know, 13-year-old dog, unilateral infection, think neoplasia before anything else. You might not be able to see it because of all the goo, but it should be on your list. Systemic disease. And then I have treatment effects in quotes here. I'm talking about things like ear plucking at the groomer. So it's a huge debate, and I don't know that I have the right answer. But typically, I tell folks not to have their dog's ears plucked unless I've got the dog under anesthesia and I'm trying to get some of that stuff, and they already have infection, basically. If the canal's already inflamed, I'll do it. Otherwise, I say, no, it's probably going to lead to more inflammation than good. Cameo, it's my dog. So otitis externa, the incidence in dogs is pretty high. It's 7.5 to 16.5. It's definitely one of the most common things that all of us see. Cats is going to be a little bit lower, so 2 to 6.2. Young dogs, but it can happen in any breed for any reason. Chronicity is going to be a factor. So those perpetuating factors that we talk about might determine whether or not that dog has disease as an older animal. No sex predilection. And of course, there's breed predisposition. And you guys are familiar with all of these. But Cocker Spaniels, for example, we know that they have more cerumen glands in their, more dense amount of cerumen glands in their ear canals than other breeds, and they're also larger and more hyperplastic. So not only do they have these long, droopy canals that are going to be predisposed to moisture, they actually have more of those glands in there that are supposed to be helping them, but typically don't. And then Labs, Goldens, Westies, German Shepherd dogs, which are predisposed to everything, poodles, and then in our kitties, Himalayans and Persians are probably overrepresented for otitis externa. So we mentioned this a little bit already, I'll just reiterate, but when they have otitis externa, that epidermis and dermis get hyperplastic, so they grow, they have too many layers. Hair follicles, sebaceous glands, cerumen glands become hyperplastic and excrete things they shouldn't be. And then, as I mentioned before, there's an increase in density of these glands as a result of the inflammation that predisposes them to infections in the future. With everything, but particularly in derm, I'm sure every specialist says that, but clinical signs and history are super important. So these are obvious for the most part, but you're going to look for itchy ears, exudate, odor. Odor might be the only thing that owners notice at first if the dog's not shaking their head, and discomfort. Important questions for their history, and this is probably the most abbreviated derm history ever, but previous episodes, is this a chronic thing? That chronicity is going to set us up for a different type of infection, so that's something you want to know for sure. Is there a seasonal component? Certainly we'd be thinking about atopy if they get ear infections every spring. Is this the only lesion that the dog has? Or do they lick their feet? Are their bottoms of their toes red? Do they have exudate coming from their toes? Do they swim? Do they go to the groomer? And then lastly, for our contact reaction, are any of the medications that you've used making their pain level worse, making their exudate worse? So next on the otic exam, so we mentioned kind of, this is all kind of reiterating things. This is a smack you in the face lesion, but this is something my mentor always talked about with me, and I appreciate it. But what would you guys call this lesion? Hotspot, right? So theoretically, it's not. So a hotspot should be something that is acute. So you go to work, you come home, the dog's chewed a hole in its side. And hotspots, by definition, have to also be caused by the mouth. And this dog didn't do this with their mouth. So this lesion can still be caused by an itch from flea allergy, which is what people think of when they think of hot spots. But this lesion has deep infection, and it's probably been going on a lot longer than they realize. And a lot of times if you clip and clean these, you'll see what we call satellite lesions, but little papules that are extending around this area of moist dermatitis. And that means that there's pyoderma there and needs to be on systemic antibiotics. So I bring it up when I talk about hot spots, but it's also something that immediately you're going to say, I need to do an otic exam and a cytology if you see this type of lesion. But once again, itchy ears, inflammation, there's going to be hyperplastic changes on the penna of that dog. We usually do our otic exams in the treatment area. It's a little bit easy for us to do. We can restrain the dogs better. For those of you who feel the same way, you can learn a lot by just palpating that dog's ears in the exam room. So they're going to be inflamed, calcified. You can see if the ears are asymmetrical. You want to open their mouth. See if the dog has jaw pain when you open their mouth. Those are all important things that you can do even without an otoscope. But then, of course, you're going to use your otoscope. And then do a complete derm exam. So you want to see if this is the only lesion that the dog has. So we're back to this, but it's always indicated for your dermatologic exam. There's, of course, the handheld version versus the video otoscope. And I know some practices have kind of either older or nicer video otoscopes that you can just do in an awake patient. Does anybody have one of those? No? Cool. So it's nice because your handheld otoscope magnifies what you're seeing 2 to 4 times depending on the handheld scope, whereas the video ones are magnifying it about 40 times depending on, once again, what your scope is. So you really do get a better view, and especially if it's a good dog, a lot of times they'll let you look in with that video otoscope. We had one that we let the students use that was like Fisher-Price, my first video otoscope. They had to kind of like smack the TV to get it to turn on, but it's really helpful, and you can see stuff that you're more confident about. For example, a mass. But typically, we reserve it for anesthetized patients, patients that we're going to biopsy a mass in the ear, for cats, for inflammatory polyps, if we're going to do a meningotomy. That's typically when we bring out the big scope. But it's not wrong to do it for an otitis externa that's a little bit more simple. Our goals with our otic exam are primarily going to be to evaluate that vertical and horizontal canal. So we're going to look for the things that I talk about, So that's cerumen gland hyperplasia. Typically, a nice healthy ear canal is going to be pink and smooth. Cerumen gland hyperplasia, and I couldn't find a picture that I liked, of course. It looks like a cobblestone street. So that is those little glands that have gotten too hypertrophied from the chronic inflammation of ear infections. So even if there's not an infection present, that tells you there's inflammation present in the canal. What type of exudate is in there? So if it's ceruminous exudate, you might think one type of infection. If it's purulent exudate, you might think of a different type of infection. Are there any erosions or ulcerations in the canal? So once again, those things might mean a different type of infection, or they might mean a contact reaction. So contact reaction, we usually see ulcerations, we usually see purulent debris. So those things are important. And of course, you want to assess the tympanic membrane. Everyone thinks it's the be-all, end-all, but how often do you think we can see a tympanic membrane with an active otitis externa? 40%, maybe, and that's generous. You're not always going to be able to do that, and don't fret. It's probably not going to change the way you treat this animal. And hopefully in the future, when they come back for their recheck, you can get a better look. So we just use this same Welsh Allen that everybody has. I do think it's important to mention the 4-millimeter cones. They're big enough to let you visualize everything, but still small enough that I've had one small cat that I had to go get a small cone for. But we use the 4-millimeter ones all day, every day. That's the only ones that we use. I think you can see a lot better with them, and I didn't realize that till residency. Part of the otic exam, of course, is going to be really good restraint. I would say pretty much always going to need a second person. Even if it's the best dog in the world, you're just not going to be able to do a very good exam without that second hand to hold the ear. You want to have them in a neutral position so that they're comfortable. Unless it's a dog without a face, have them grab the muzzle. I think that's the most comfortable way for them to not jerk their head. And of course, you want to be safe. Muzzles might interfere because they can just push against that canal and prevent you from looking. And that's something to be aware of. But your face is going to be really close to that animal's mouth. And obviously, that is more important most of the time. So be aware of that. We use different cones in each ear. And a lot of people are surprised by that, but you can transfer infectious organisms from one canal to the other, especially if it's something like Pseudomonas. We want to be careful about that. And of course, you're going to want to evaluate both ears. We typically start with the one that's less affected because that seems to make the dog or cat less angry. And they usually let you get to the second one. And you might not be able to do it. So that's something that you have to realize. Especially if you lift up that ear and you're like, I can't even get a swab in here, probably not going to be able to get a cone in there. And it's just going to make the animal angry and not let you do it the next time. So we do sometimes forego the otic exam if it's that stenotic. Most of the time you can still get a swab, at least in the area of the external canal, to get a sample of what you're dealing with. But especially if you can't do it that first day, great. They go home with a short course of oral steroids, and you see them back when the inflammation's down a little bit. So to continue, as I mentioned before, just a fun anatomical term to learn, but that's where you want to start. I always pick up the ear from the base, and you pull it up and out towards you. So if you think about that canal being a vertical and a horizontal canal, you want it to be straightened out as much as possible. And then this, the flap of O'Neill, as my fearless leader calls it, because it doesn't have a name. Yep. So you can avoid it by kind of trying to go in a straight line as opposed to getting your otoscope to curve, which is not going to work, and you're not going to be able to see it anyway. And then don't hit the flap of O'Neill, because that's when they jump. Okay, diagnostics. We talked about history, how important that is. We talked about exam. And then cytology is probably the most important thing that we do for ears. It defines the problem for us. So what type of infectious organism is present? Are there inflammatory cells? If they are, what type of cells? Are there neoplastic cells that you're worried about? Parasites. Mite preps are easy. If you just take some of that ceruminous debris, chop it up with the edge of the Q-tip, the not Q-tip edge, and then put it in mineral oil, just like your scrapes. Cover slip on there. Look at it on under 10x. We see Demodex in ears, which is, you know, if it's in the ear canals, you're probably gonna find it elsewhere. It's usually not the only lesion, but it's really cool. So there's that. I mean, it's just fun to be like, oh, hey, Demodex from the ears. And then most parasites like are easy to kill and probably are already deceased from your current flea prevention, but it's fun to find. It's gonna guide your treatment plan. So if I see a certain type of bacteria, I'm gonna reach for something. Even if I'm culturing, I'm gonna send home something empirically. And then it gives you a baseline for all your recheck exams. So like I said before, you might have cleared that infection 90%, and then you let it go because you didn't do a cytology. Oh, they look great, the dog's clinically way better, and they're gonna come back in 3 weeks, and you're gonna say, crap, did this infection recur? Do I need to do a food trial, or did I never get rid of it in the first place? So owners are always like, we don't wanna pay for it again, you did it last time. Well, it's still warranted. So, and then when do you culture? And culturing for ears is tricky. So if it's not responding to empiric therapy, it's certainly a reason to culture. It will give you some more information on your susceptibility report. And this is, I should mention that I'm talking about bacteria here. There's no reason to culture Malassezia. It's not gonna give you any information. If it's not responding properly and it's yeast, hey, there might be a mass in there that you're not seeing or some other predisposing factor that we don't know about. So there's no indication to culture yeast. But for bacteria, but what I tell folks, and I had a phone call today, is that that susceptibility panel, it might not be as useful as you think. For some organisms, sure, it's going to help you, but we're getting concentrations at the level of that infection thousands of times higher than the plasma levels of that drug. And so even if it says resistant on your susceptibility panel, it might be susceptible at those concentrations. So you might still choose an antibiotic that is listed as resistant. One in particular that I don't is fluoroquinolones. If they're resistant to Pseudomonas, I usually will skip it because of their particular mutation. Rods on cytology. Once again, Pseudomonas is what we're talking about. That's the big scary one here, but we want to confirm that that's what it is. There are some other rods, for example, gram-positive rods like Carinibacterium, that are usually not going to cause all the inflammation that you're seeing with Pseudomonas. You usually don't see neutrophils on cytology, but we should still confirm what organism it is because it's going to completely change our treatment plan. We treat Pseudomonas very differently. And then, lastly, if you see inflammatory cells on your cytology, but you don't see any infectious organisms. And the reason for this is the number one suspicion is going to be contact reaction. So we talked about Pseudomonas causing inflammation. Well, contact reaction can cause that same inflammation. You want to confirm it with a sterile culture or a culture that shows very little growth, that you're confident it was not the causative problem. Briefly, again, clinical signs are going to be huge, especially your neurologic signs. So vestibular signs, facial nerve paralysis, things of that nature, Horner's disease. Otoscopic exam may or may not be helpful. So if you can see that tympanic membrane perfectly, and it's a Cavalier King Charles, and it has a bulging pars flaccida, great. I have otitis, primary otitis media on my list. So the primary secretory otitis media of Cavaliers, which we may or may not get to, but that is not going to happen that often. So otitis media is largely something that we're going to base on clinical signs. Skull radiographs are not very diagnostic, and they're really hard to take. So we rely pretty heavily on advanced imaging to diagnose that disease. And if it's indicated after that point is usually when we'll do the meningotomy. So these are my pearls of wisdom, which I kind of usually save for the end, but then I thought it might be better to think about these things when I'm going through products, just to help you along. And we'll reiterate at the end with why I think they're so important. But once again, diagnostics. Cytology is the first thing, of course, but culturing when we need to as well. Secondly, we're going to want to decrease the swelling of that ear. Most dermatologists will preach never use topical steroids on the skin, very rarely. We don't do it that often. So, you know, the Panalog that you rub on the hot spot, we don't love that. Neoprodev powder, we don't love that. Ears are the opposite. We're like, put some steroid in there. And it doesn't have to be topical necessarily, but topical or systemic, most of the time, unless there's a reason this animal shouldn't have a steroid, like you're going to run a thyroid panel on it the next week, they probably need steroids to decrease the inflammation in that ear. So once again, kind of the opposite of what we say for skin. So it makes ears a little different. And then we need clean ears. So we're going to talk a lot about flushes. We're not going to get contact of our medication with that canal if the ears are full of junk. And it also can be a nidus for infection. We want to keep clean ears if they're going to be predisposed. Volume of medication. This is a huge pitfall that we see. So all of those little medication bottles have an applicator that looks like a spaghetti string, and they say put 3 to 4 drops in there. Well, you have no idea what they're putting in there. They have no idea what they're putting in there. And I'm going to recommend way more meds than you're used to recommending. So 3 to 4 drops is not nearly enough. So we say 1 ml in large dogs and 0.5 ml in small dogs and cats. So if you have a bilateral infection in a large dog, you're sending home 60 milliliters of meds. And you want to send home, and it's expensive. But guess what? They're doing a lot better when they get back to you. And we do, usually we'll send home a dropper in a brown medicine bottle or tuberculin syringes. So you know, you show them exactly how much to draw up. And if they show back up to your clinic with half of the bottle still there, you know there's a compliance issue. So we're going to do 1 ml twice a day and in, you know, the affected canals. And then recheck, huge. I mentioned again that owners don't necessarily see why it's so important that they have to come back in and see you in 2 weeks if the dog is doing better. And if it's doing great, fantastic. But you need to know if that infection's gone in order to guide their future infections that they're going to get. And then, you know, you need to know if it's working. So 2 weeks is usually what we say for a recheck. Maintenance plan. A puppy that goes swimming for the first time and gets a yeast otitis, probably you don't need to do a whole lot of work yet. You know, treat the infection. Here's your basic ear flush for after bathing. And a lot of dogs swim their whole lives and don't get ear infections, so you might not even need that. But every animal that has one can be predisposed for more, so I would certainly think about something like that. It might be a dog that has more chronic ears. You're not ready to send them for Tika, but you can't clear that infection. It'll get way better. But then as soon as you stop meds, it comes back. Well, maybe they need Otomax twice a week, you know, and that's not too much. And then, you know, flushing we pretty much recommend as a maintenance for everyone that has chronic ears. And then lastly, the underlying cause. And that's the tough part. Like I said, if it's their first time infection, maybe don't jump on a diet trial right away. A lot of folks will try to put an animal on a diet trial that has chronic ears. And if that's their only symptom, and they already have chronic changes, guess what? It doesn't matter. You got to manage those ears. The food's not going to fix it at that point. But if it's only getting ear infections in the spring, licking its feet, you know, think about treating for atopy during those months. Purpose of ear cleaning. So it's to remove cerumen and debris. Like I said, we need contact of our medication with the canal, and then we want to remove that nidus for potential future infections. They can be used as drying agents for after swimming. And then lastly, a lot of them have antimicrobial properties. This seems a little busy, but what I tell the vet students, what I did when I was a resident, is you don't have to know every flush out there. And these, a lot of the companies are buying each other up. You're not going to remember who sells what product, but if you can pick up the back of the bottle and identify what those active ingredients do, you're going to be able to choose the flush that is good for that patient and do it on a case-by-case basis. Our potent ceruminolytics, so these are things that you're mostly going to use in the clinic. They're greasy messes. They're great at breaking up wax, but number one, they're irritating, so you're going to have to rinse them out afterwards. And number two, your owners are going to hate you if you send that home because their Cocker Spaniel is going to be, you know, like a greased pig, basically. Squalene has a little star beside it because it's the only one that we've proven to be safe in the middle ear. The rest of them probably are, because we're going to flush them out. Yes, they can be irritating, but we're going to flush afterwards, and so if it's not sitting in that middle ear, you're probably okay. Less potent ceruminolytics, salicylic acid and propylene glycol, both of these are in tons of different flushes. Propylene glycol gets 2 stars by it because it's a big culprit for contact reactions. So maybe if you have that bag of stuff that the owner brings in and you think you have a contact reaction, you get your sterile culture back, that might be a good place to start. Remove that propylene glycol first. Drying agents, alcohols and acids. The salicylic's not quite as aggressive, but typically we won't really love these products, and they're in everything, but they can be irritating. We're treating mostly animals that have chronic inflamed ears, and it's a painful, putting alcohol on a skinned knee is painful. They don't usually love it. Same thing with pouring vinegar on it. And so we try to avoid these products. We try to go for something that's a little bit less irritating for our chronic ears. Not to say that you couldn't send home with a puppy pack an alcohol-based flush. Here's for after your bath. You know, that dog's canals are perfectly healthy. It's probably going to be just fine. But for our chronic ears, we usually don't like that. Antimicrobial agents. Once again, alcohols and acids. Don't love them for the aforementioned reasons. Azoles, they're throwing those in a lot of stuff these days. Propylene glycol actually has some antimicrobial properties. The monosaccharides, I'll get back to that, but that's in a specific flush that we like. And then the chlorxylenol and chlorhexidine. And chlorhexidine is theoretically can be ototoxic above 0.2% concentration. And we can talk about that with one of the flushes that I have too. So we technically don't love chlorhexidine in any of our flushes, but a lot of them are out there at lower concentrations. Now we're here to products, which hopefully you guys will enjoy maybe more than that first part. But it can be kind of like, obviously the joke's been out there for 15 minutes now, but drinking water out of a fire hose, because there's so many different products. But as I said before, the most important thing is just knowing what those active ingredients do, having a couple of key things on your shelf so you don't have to have all of it, and then kind of picking what you need case by case. So pick this as kind of a generic example of an ear flush that is, it's got alcohol in it, salicylic acid, propylene glycol, pretty classic. You know, this is kind of the foot soldier of ear flushes. It's not that it's terrible. We avoid it because most of the time we're treating inflamed ears and it's too irritating for them. And so we're going to pick something that doesn't have alcohol. The product that we use actually does have salicylic acid in it, but it's not typically as irritating. But as I said, you know, I will admit that I use this product on my dogs that don't have otitis. You know, it's fine, especially after swimming, bathing. It's just maybe a little too irritating for chronic infections. And then here are some products that probably everyone has seen. So I'll just share some pearls. But looking back, we did talk about chlorhexidine as an antimicrobial that is found in some flushes. It's actually not legal to put otic on the medication if it has chlorhexidine in it. And so that's why when you look at this Malaceb, it says flush, but what does it look like it's geared to? Ears, of course. And so the percentage concentration of the chlorhexidine is lower than it would be. So we recommend for skin, for example, 2% to 4%. So shampoos, sprays, mousses, which we love, of course. This is 0.2% chlorhexidine, and then the miconazole in it is 0.2% as well. So it's really not only potentially ototoxic, but it also is not at a very high concentration that you would want it to be to kill organisms. So we just skip it most of the time. People might think, well, maybe I could squirt it on a cotton ball or a wipe and use it interdigitally or some other problem areas. But once again, your other products are going to be 10 times more powerful, and they're typically not irritating unless the animal has a contact reaction. So we don't really find a good use for this product. Zymox, I'm sure that you guys have heard of this. It's that three enzyme system, and you know they have the shampoo and conditioner, but lysozyme, lactoferrin, and lactoperoxidase. And those are antimicrobial peptides that the skin cells should be making naturally. They're supposed to fight off our infectious organisms. The thought is that there's a barrier defect for animals with food allergy and atopy. They're not making those antimicrobial peptides like they should be. And so let's replace them It's not going to cause antibiotic resistance. It's natural, all those good things. But really, it doesn't work very well. Using it as a maintenance flush where you're trying to get debris out of the canal, I would say that that's not a terrible idea. I don't have a problem with it per se. But as a medical treatment, it doesn't do the job. It just doesn't have the power that we like it to. They do make some variations of this product that would have hydrocortisone in it, for example, which is a really mild steroid. So we talked about maintenance plans. Maybe it's a dog that has environmental allergy and it has itchy ears, and you do your cytology, and the ears were red on otic exam, but not super exudative. You do your cytology, and there's no infection. So you're like, well, crap, the dog's ears are itchy. What am I going to do? This might be a good option that's gentle if you don't want to do aggressive steroids, or if this is enough to keep the dog happy and it doesn't have to be on Apoquil or steroids or all that stuff. So that it's an option. The hydrocortisone might be good for allergic otitis. So this is the one that we use like water, essentially. So Epiotic Advanced, they don't make Epiotic Regular anymore unless they've changed that. So there's a couple of things about it that we like it. The salicylic acid is going to be the ceruminolytic. Most of the animals that we see need a ceruminolytic. They need something because there's going to be so much inflammation, wax, goo in that ear, we have to get it out. And so that is one of the reasons why we like this one. It's non-irritating, it has a neutral pH. So no alcohol, no acetic acid. Importantly, for using fluoroquinolones, they are rendered inert in an acidic flush. So if you're using malacetic with your Posatex or your Baytril Dex, it's not working. Or at least it shouldn't, theoretically. So just something to think about. And that's why a lot of those flushes you see that are geared towards Pseudomonas infections, which use fluoroquinolones, they're that T8 and a basic pH. So that's why they market those that way. It also does not have propylene glycol in it. So that is, you know, a big deal for us when we're suspicious of contact reactions. At least I am, even when it's not happening. But at least you can be like, hey, there's no propylene glycol in this product. So those are some of the reasons why we really like it. It's more expensive than some of the other ones, but this is pretty much what we go to unless there's a reason not to. Malacetic Ultra, I like this one for what I call yeasty swimmers. So it does have acetic acid in it, and so it's going to be a little bit more irritating, but it's good for drying. It's good for yeast with that low pH. It does have ketoconazole in it, and it has hydrocortisone in it. So we're missing a big category. This isn't Jeopardy, but ceruminolytics. So if you have a dog that has a ton of wax in its ears, this is not going to be very helpful at all because you're going to have a hard time fighting that infection due to all the wax. If it's a dog that gets a yeast infection every time it swims, great. You know, so this might be a good product for that type of animal. But that's just an example of what I mean by picking the active ingredients to fit your case appropriately. This, what does it look like? Yeah, looks like chlorhexidine. It's not. It's just blue. So they can't put otic on a chlorhexidine solution. Most of the ingredients in this are proprietary. We do know that it has a really low percent alcohol in it. We use this a lot for suspected contact allergies. And I will fully admit that it's just because my mentor did it, and I have good luck with it. So it seems that the dogs that react to certain flushes don't typically react to this one. So that's why we choose it. That is my logic. It's terrible logic, but it works. So we usually keep this on our shelves too. Threamine. So this one has squalene in it. So this would be an example of the flush to use as an in-house product. And we'll talk about kind of our process for how we do that. Once again, safe in the middle ear. You don't have to worry about that ruptured TM. And it works pretty well. There's actually some products that are off the market now that had, one had DSS and urea peroxide in it, the other two potent ceruminolytics, and I liked it better, but I don't have a choice in it any longer. So at-home cleaning, we've kind of harped on this already, but we're going to do it usually twice weekly. We like non-irritating products with a ceruminolytic in them. We use a ton of volume. It does go through it quicker, but it works a lot more effectively. So you're going to fill up the entire canal. massage the ear canals, and then let them shake their head out. And then make sure we're telling everyone not to put Q-tips down there. They can wipe away the excess with a tissue or cotton ball from the opening of the canal, but don't stick anything down in there. Ear flushing in the non-sedated or anesthetized patient. We do this with them awake. I've never had a dog. I've had some bad dogs, but most of them tolerate this pretty darn well. So a lot of times you don't need to anesthetize them to do this. So we're going to take that potent cerumenolytic with those ingredients we talked about earlier in the evening, put it in the ears, 5 to 15 minutes. You guys usually don't do day cases, but if they can stay for a little while and have that marinate even longer, that's great. Massage it. And then you can just take water. It doesn't have to be sterile water. It doesn't have to be saline. Just a clean dish with warm water so it's more comfortable to them. And you wrap them up in their towel, and you're going to bulb syringe, and you're going to get a jet action going. So I don't want to make the noise because it's embarrassing, but you're going to get a good jet action going with your bulb syringe. The important thing to remember is don't make a seal with the opening of the ear canal, because you can pop that tympanic membrane and then flush all that goo into their middle ear, and that is not good for anyone involved. So just make sure you don't make a seal. And then if you look in their ears afterwards, it's really satisfying. You know, they're just like, yes, this worked great. Sedated anesthetized patients, we touched on this earlier. We're usually going to reserve this for patients who are suspicious of CT to evaluate for otitis media. Certainly if we're suspicious of a mass and we do CT or MRI. We clean the ear with these guys too. And typically we're trying to get a sample from the middle ear if we're suspicious of otitis media. So we're going to try to get into that tympanic membrane with either a Tomcat catheter or a French, depending on how friable the ear is. I don't recommend doing that blind, though. It's really, and I'm biased because I have a machine that gives me a good visualization, but typically we reserve it for doing it here. People will do meningotomies at home. It's just a little difficult to see if you're going to hit those ossicles when you can't visualize. And when you're trying to look through your handheld otoscope with an instrument, it's just really difficult to do. We have a port that we can put the instrument in and just watch it happen. And then just flushing that debris. If they're anesthetized, you don't have to have a fancy scope, but if they're not going to let you do it, you do need to start with a canal that's clean, or once again, our meds are not going to get good contact. Here's are just some examples of the common bacteria that we see with bacterial otitis. We've talked about Pseudomonas before. We talked a little bit about Carinibacterium. And I'll pick certain medications for our gram positives, and then our gram negatives usually will go a different route. We're going to rarely avoid topical therapy. So almost every case of otitis externa is going to require topical meds. Large volumes, like we talked about in our keys to success, and then we'll talk about whether to do it once a day or twice daily. Systemic medications we don't do very often, and I would tell myself, with few exceptions, usually only when there's suspected otitis media. The typical, what I would say, garden variety bacterial or yeast otitis externa, most cases we're going to use our ear cleaner, and then we're going to have polypharmacy. So usually it's going to be a medication that has an antibiotic, an antifungal, and a topical glucocorticoid mixed in with it. And we have a lot to choose from. We didn't used to. And we're going to do it twice daily, and then recheck in 2 weeks, like we mentioned before. These are some more sort of foot soldier workhorse treatment medications as opposed to flush. But everybody's familiar with these, I'm sure. Otamax, Mometamax, Trezoderm. Otamax and Mometamax were the same company, and they have the same antibiotic, which is gentamicin, same antifungal. The steroids are different. So Mometamax has mometasone, and it's thought to be a soft steroid, but still stronger, or it lasts longer, I should say, was the marketing technique. So Otamax is labeled for twice a day. Mometamax is labeled for once a day. But we know that we get way better treatment outcomes, and we need that twice a day of our antimicrobials. And so even if we're scripting out Mometamax because we want a stronger steroid, we're going to prescribe it for twice daily. And like we talked about with the volume, 1 mil for big dogs, half for small and cats. Trezoderm, similar concept. So you have your polypharmacy with a steroid, antibiotic, and antifungal. it's a liquid formulation. So to get a steroid into liquid, you have to use alcohol. So there's alcohol in this product. Secondly, it is kept in the refrigerator. So there are two factors that pets don't really love. So for that reason, we don't usually use it. You could argue that a liquid formulation is better for a stenotic canal, for example. But for me, I'd rather do a short course of steroids and then start medication because I like the coverage that an ointment offers better. I just feel like it covers better. So I don't really use that product. There's nothing, you know, inherently wrong with it by any means. These are some newer products that are out there that most of you have probably heard of. I got some information about Claro. You guys might have seen this on Venn. I don't frequent Venn. But apparently, it's in humans been associated with corneal ulcers. Like two technicians were reported where the animal shook afterwards and it hit their eye and they got corneal ulcers. So, word to the wise, it is applied in the clinic, so it's something maybe you need to train your staff for, but hopefully owners wouldn't have problems with it unless they're present when you're putting the medication in there. Both of these products came out around the same time. They have similar ingredients as well. Fluorphenicol is going to be the antibiotic that they chose. And then they have different steroids, but they both have terbinafine in them as their antifungal. Claro is labeled for 30 days. So you do one application, don't touch the ears for 30 days, theoretically. And it makes sense because the vehicle that they use is supposed to be really adherent to the epithelium without being a pack, without being wax. But it makes sense if it attaches to corneal epithelium as well, so that's unfortunate. But Claro is labeled for one dose, 30 days. Osurnia is actually labeled for 45. You do one dose at day one, and then day seven or day eight, a week later, you do the second dose. And then theoretically, you're not supposed to have to touch it for 45 days. If you're doing flushes with this product, it's going to lose efficacy. I don't dislike these products. I use them, but for certain scenarios only. So for example, if it's a difficult to medicate cat, great. Especially if it's bilateral, I'll split a bilateral yeast otitis in a kitty, I'll split the 1 ml tube into two and apply a half to each ear. It's very cost effective for the owner and I've had good efficacy. For dogs that are mean, great. I get it. It makes sense. I will say for a chronic ear that is inflamed and exudative, you're not going to have good luck with this product. And, you know, I don't know this, but my theory is that it's too exudative for it to adhere properly and it's just going to kind of shed more quickly. So Pseudomonas ears, first of all, fluorphenicol is a bad choice for that organism anyway, but it's so exudative. If it's a chronic ear that's not Pseudomonas, it might be a different type of bacteria, you still might not have great luck. So we like our twice daily treatment for the most part. The other thing that is kind of the just pessimist in me is that fluorphenicol is an antibiotic that is similar to chloramphenicol. We deal with resistant staph, methicillin-resistant staph pseudintermedius daily. Chloramphenicol is frequently one of the drugs that's still left to us. It's not a benign drug by any stretch of the imagination, but it's better than amikacin. Part of me is afraid that we're going to lose chloramphenicol if people are using this willy-nilly to treat a yeast otitis, because you might be interfering with the natural staph of that animal. And I don't know that that's going to happen, but that just makes me sad to think about. Talk about Pseudomonas. This is a big question category that we get over the phone a lot. I wanted to chat about the clinical appearance of these ears first. Usually this is not a first-time infection dog. Usually it's chronic otitis externa. They've had infections their whole lives. They were being treated for, you know, yeast otitis, and they come in. Things are a little bit worse. They're more painful. They smell worse. You flip up that ear. It's erosive. It's, you know, dripping yellow goo. And then, of course, you're going to do your cytology first thing, and you see neutrophils and sheets of rod bacteria. That is typically what it looks like. It looks like a single infection. It's usually not sharing the canal with many other organisms. It's kind of chased them all away. So that's what it's going to look like typically. And we do recommend culturing to prove that's who you're dealing with. You're still going to send home treatment recommendations while your culture is out because that dog is painful. But that's what you're going to be suspicious of. We have several different treatment options, which should be a good thing, but usually it means that one of them's not great. You know, there's not one that works all the time. So unfortunately, it's a little bit of a crystal ball situation where you're trying to guess which ones are going to work. Typically, we start with a fluoroquinolone. So that would be the antibiotic I would start with. I would say that if the dog's been exposed to fluoroquinolones, either systemically or topically, we usually don't have it anymore. We usually lose susceptibility to it. As far as the cleaner, I think the Epiotic Advance is a great choice, and we would still recommend twice weekly because we don't want to over-irritate the canal. The one thing that we do differently with Pseudomonas ears is the Triz EDTA flush. So I'm sure you guys have all heard of Triz EDTA. It's actually a calcium chelator, so it binds calcium. But what that does is the gram-negative bacteria need calcium to close their pores. And they developed this cool little efflux pump where you can get bacteria inside of the gram-negative organism, and then it pumps it, you get the antibiotic inside the organism and it pumps it right back out. The Triz EDTA will bind the calcium. They can't close their pores anymore. And so we get way more medication into the cell than can be pumped out by that efflux pump. So that was one mechanism of resistance of Pseudomonas that we've kind of been able to overtake. So usually we'll do Triz EDTA 5 to 15 minutes before your medication, usually no matter what it is. And like I said, the fluoroquinolones are a good place to start. You can use the injectable enrofloxacin or Baytrol. The large animal is less expensive, of course. It's technically illegal unless you have a mixed animal practice, but most people are not too afraid of that. Posatex has orbifloxacin, which is also a fluoroquinolone, so something to consider if you don't want to do your own compounding. So for example, Posatex has a nice potent steroid in it already, so you could do Triz EDTA, 1 mL of Posatex per affected canal, and then you're twice a week with the Epiotic Advanced. You could also do that with your Baytrol, which we usually compound with dexamethasone. There's some formulations that have all three, so dex, Baytrol, and Triz, but usually that dilutes your Baytrol too much. So either just do Baytrol dex, or you can do Triz Baytrol and put them on oral steroids. They're going to need a steroid because this is worse than most infections. There's a reason why these don't work. Gentamicin theoretically should have spectrum against Pseudomonas. However, for whatever reason, the binding site on the ribosome of neutrophils is really similar to the bacteria. So the gentamicin will bind to the mammalian neutrophil, and then it gets all eaten up, essentially, and there's no drug left to treat the bacteria. So that's why we see failure with purulent debris. So we don't have that as a choice. For some reason, amikacin doesn't do that, and they should have very similar binding sites, so I don't know why. But we have good luck with amikacin and dex compounded for Pseudomonas ears. So once again, Triz EDTA, amikacin, dex twice a day, and then you're flush twice a week. Silver sulfadiazine is something you can compound, and it's relatively inexpensive. We've had some good luck with that too, and we don't worry about things like bacterial resistance, which is nice. So if it works, wonderful. Polymyxin B, which is the one in Surlan, used to work pretty well. And then Europe lost it, and now we've sort of lost it. It still works sometimes, but it just does not seem to be working against Pseudomonas as well as it used to. There are some injectable cephalosporins that Pseudomonas is susceptible to. So ceftazidine and timetin are examples. And usually it'll come in a gram container, and you would reconstitute it with initially with 10 mLs of sterile water. Then you have to move it to an appropriate container. This is not a perfected technique, by the way, but some people would say 100 mLs of saline or sterile water per gram. I usually do 60 because that's a two-week treatment for me, and I'm like, oh, that's a little bit higher concentration. No big deal, because there's not been any studies to say what concentration we need. You have to pull it up into individual tuberculin syringes and freeze them until you're ready to use them. I've only ever had one failure of it, so it's pretty good record. Those are kind of the laundry list of things that I feel Pseudomonas works. The pred dose, anti-inflammatory in dogs and cats. So dogs is typically what we're talking about with Pseudomonas, so a mg per kg. if you're not going to have a steroid in your topical. So back to the TRIZ. These bug me. They made this T8 keto as a prophylactic measure for Pseudomonas infections. So we talked about pH, how yeast don't like an acidic pH and they do like a basic pH. This is going to be an 8 because we want to protect our fluoroquinolone if that's what we're going to choose. It also has ketoconazole in it. So people think it's a flush for yeast otitis. It is not. I will have dogs come in on this flush and they just have yeast teeming out of their ears because they laugh at the ketoconazole because they're just healthy enough in that environment. So this is to prevent yeast overgrowth once you get rid of your Pseudomonas, because a lot of times once you do, the yeast will get really excited that the bully is gone and take back over. You know, good idea for Pseudomonas infections, bad idea for yeast infections. Long-term maintenance, we've touched on briefly, but if it's recurrent, we're probably going to need topical medications on a weekly basis, at least lifelong. Owners don't love to hear that, but if you tell them that after they've been doing it like 3 times a day, and you're like, hey, you only have to do it twice a week, they get a little bit less sad. You know, the only other true way to fix it is with a TICA, with a palliative effort. Otherwise, we're never going to resolve it. And then I mentioned addressing the primary cause. I also talked about, you know, if they're really that end stage, you're potentially not even going to change your maintenance level because we've lost some of those microscopic barrier mechanisms that we had before. So they might still be susceptible to predisposed to ear infections in the future. Steroids, again, benefits. We use them almost all the time unless there is an exception. So for example, endocrine testing, you're going to want to avoid it because you're not going to be able to tell if the dog's really hypothyroid or if it's Otomax affecting the test. So there are a plethora of studies out there amongst mostly veterinary dermatologists and their residents that looked at the adrenal suppression with topical steroids. You can see it's not 100% across the board, but tons of these cases had suppression of the adrenal axis, and this is just with Otomax, for example. So, you know, if that dog is on ear meds and you do a thyroid panel, you cannot say for sure, you know, that it wasn't. If it's borderline, you know, it's thyroid's 1-2, you're not going to know. It could have been the ear meds. And so I tell people to, you know, save your money, wait until they're off ear meds for a couple of weeks before you do that thyroid testing. Because even though they say Mometamax won't do it, it's possible. Ototoxicity, I think this is an important point to bring up. Remember that anything is potentially ototoxic, including ear infections. It can damage the apparatus, and it can be conductive loss as well. So if their ears are completely calcified shut, probably not going to be hearing very well. We talked about how squalene is safe. We want to avoid this stuff with a ruptured tympanic membrane. We also mentioned that we're not going to know a lot of the time. Certainly, aminoglycosides are probably the most implicated that we talk about, so gentamicin, amikacin. If you see a ruptured TM, of course, avoid it. Like I said, you're not going to know, and I still send Otomax home. You know, I don't, you know, quake in fear to do that. It's not, you know, it's usually going to be fine. Counsel your owners, hey, this is possible. Watch for hearing loss. We don't know what the exact numbers are. One of my mentors said 1 in 20,000 at some point. I think it's more than that because I see it pretty frequently and I haven't seen that many dogs. It can also transfuse across that tympanic membrane. So you can have a perfectly intact TM. If it's a lot harder for it to cause ototoxicity, but it's still possible. So even that intact TM doesn't save you. And you're still going to use those products, and we all use them all the time. But avoid it if you do know that the TM is ruptured. And theoretically, polymyxin B could do it as well. Neomycin, which is in trezoderm, people don't realize, so they'll switch from Otomax to trezoderm, and the dog is deaf. If you can figure out within the first few days that you're having hearing loss, then and you stop it at that point, it's usually reversible. If they've been on it pretty chronically or it's multiple courses, then you're probably not going to get the hearing back. End-stage otitis externa, unfortunately, TICA is really our option there. So we turf them to the surgeons. I don't hesitate to recommend people to do this if they want to, because I've seen how good the quality of life can be for these animals afterwards. And it just makes everyone happier. Dogs don't hold a grudge, so even though they lose their hearing, they're probably going to be happier in the end. So I'll only try to medically manage if, you know, I think we can be successful. We've talked about this quite a bit already, contact reactions. You're going to have to rely on your history to be able to diagnose this. Worsening with treatment. So, and then neutrophils on cytology without any organisms. And then to confirm it, you're going to do your culture and make sure that it's a sterile reaction. Usually we put these guys on steroids, discontinue the offending product. And as I said, this Novasan Otic is a good option for contact reactions, even though we don't know what's in it. And then allergic otitis, we talked about this a little bit. Itchy ears with no infection. You're going to rule out scabies, and then you're going to treat your allergy. So we talked about using a soft steroid like hydrocortisone, but if you're treating the underlying allergy, you might not need that frequently. Steroids, of course, but nobody likes to do that chronically. I wanted to reiterate my pearls to success just because I think they're so important. And even if you're not using the same medications, you're probably going to do pretty well if you stick to these guns. Also forgot to mention earlier that we typically don't flush ears in cats. It's really easy to rupture the tympanic membrane in the hospital. It's easy for owners to do it at home. So we usually avoid that step in kitties. And they usually don't need it. They don't usually have, unless it's mites, they usually don't have a ton of infection there, or a mass or a polyp, something along those lines. Of course, there's some neoplastic otitis externa cases. We kind of talked about look for the signalment of an older pet unilateral infection. There's a bunch of different varieties. They're going to require a TICA. Typically, we can usually biopsy on the derm service, but we're not fixing that tumor for the most part if it's malignant. Polyps, we can do a traction avulsion, and we might fix it. That's an old study. Basically, most of these are locally aggressive, but they don't met. Inflammatory polyps in kitties, they're really satisfying. You guys can probably do tractions just as easily as we just get better pictures. But if you can get your instruments in there, especially for a pharyngeal polyp, then you want to get it below the mass and towards the stalk and just gently towards it. It's really satisfying because they're young cats. They have had bad infections for a while. We think that the tumors are a result of chronic inflammation. So chronic inflammation in the respiratory tract that causes this overgrowth of tissue, and it either arises from the middle ear or the eustachian tube. So it can be pharyngeal, as I mentioned, stertorous breathing. And I actually like a CT in these guys too, because I'm always afraid I'm going to miss something in the middle ear or in the throat, but it's not necessarily indicated to do a CT. Otitis media. In dogs, we usually see otitis media extending from otitis externa. In cats, that's usually not true. If they have otitis media, it's usually ascending from the nasopharynx up the eustachian tube. And we usually have oral flora in that middle ear. That's usually what we culture. And then systemic antibiotics is the best treatment for these guys. Doing things for vestibular disease, so meclizine, neurologic signs. But basically, this is stuff we've already touched on. The main thing with otitis media is, you know, ideally we want to get a sample of that fluid via meningotomy, make sure we're on the correct systemic antibiotic. And then PSOM, this is just that cavalier disease that I mentioned, where they, you guys have probably heard it called glue ear, where they develop a plug in their middle ear. And the treatment for it is they usually come to us via the neuro service because people think it's a Chiari-like and a syrinx formation because they have this weird scratching and a head tilt and vestibular signs, but actually it's this strange middle ear disease. They have a bulging pars flaccida, so you can see where it looks like a bubble there. And we do a meningotomy, flush it out, and it's this big chunk of glue snot, and it's really satisfying. The dogs feel way better afterwards. It is a palliative treatment. So they're probably going to have another one of those treatments in the future. There's some things that we can use with this disease to hopefully extend the time between procedures. N-acetylcysteine is a mucolytic. You can also use guaifenesin and antihistamines. There was a dermatologist out of Ohio State that did a study with the tympanostomy tubes like little kids get, and they all got clogged or fell out. She just didn't have great success with them. Those animals usually needed a repeat procedure in 3 or 4 years anyway. And those are my two angels that don't get to go to the March Madness tournament this year, so we're very sad. But I want to have time to answer any questions for you guys.
You said that the tympanic membrane heals pretty fast, but pretty fast.
So like a week to two? I have my meningotomy rechecks at 2 weeks usually, and they're healed. It might be a little bit slower if that the ear's still pathologic. Mm-hmm. So, you know, a PSOM dog's probably going to heal faster than an otitis externa dog, because that tympanic membrane's usually healthier.
Do you try to avoid aggressive topicals until you feel like it's better?
I do typically. Looking at some of those ingredients that we used, and we don't know if the TM's ruptured anyway, I have my doubts how much damage they would really cause. It's just we don't have a ton of things proven to be safe in the middle ear, so I try to avoid it.
There's a product that a lot of clinics have been using that's compounded that they call Otipac, which is, I think it's in the lanolin-based, ketoconazole, and maybe
BNP, something. There's a few different varieties, and there are a few companies that make them. We don't love them in the sense that if we end up having to do a flush, it's like taking a little curette and scraping every little chunk away to get to the middle ear and to get the ear clean. They can be a nidus for infection. If you had a simple yeast otitis, it's probably going to be fine in the majority of animals. We see more complicated than that, so it didn't work. And it's a pain in the butt getting it off the side of the ear canal. But like I said, if it's just a yeast otitis and it's a dog that is going to try to eat you, by all means.
Blue topical ear mix for cats. If you have cats with existing type 2 diabetes.
I don't typically worry about topical steroids in general. And this is via me asking like 8 internists, because I am concerned about it. They don't feel like it alters their insulin blood glucose enough to matter. And once again, with kitties and dogs, we're not trying to get perfect blood sugar. We're trying to just keep them lower, you know, not like in people. And so if they're PUPD for a day and they really need steroids for some reason, I usually will still do it as long as it's a short-acting steroid. Other questions? But yeah, I don't have anything else for you guys.